You're listening to a Left Lion podcast.
Welcome to the Left Lion podcast. I'm Adam Pickering. I'm partnerships manager here at Left Lion, and in my spare time, you'll mostly find me looking after our environment section or running around planting trees. So today we're welcoming a musical guest, and you might be asking yourself, why are you hearing from me? Well, I'm also founder of a couple of community-led creative festivals here in Nottingham, namely Hockley Hustle Music Festival, and I'm a self-described recovering music promoter and music business guy of about 10 years, and so I've worked with today's guest a few times in booking and promoting her shows too. Yes, if you haven't guessed it, we're joined by the super soulful, long-performing and recording local musical talent that is Natalie Duncan. Natalie was performing at Hockley Hustle festivals as far back as 2007. She released her first EP on Nottingham's own Farmyard Records, and then she made a break out of knots, appearing in the TV series Goldie's Band by Royal Appointment in 2009, and went on to release her debut album on Decca Records, appear on Jules Holland, tour Japan, and has since worked with big name artists and songwriters across the musical spectrum. Natalie released her second album called Free in the summer of 2020. It was the first release on Goldie's Fallen Tree 100 label, with a gig at London's legendary Jazz Cafe to kick it all off and two sold out nights at Ronnie Scott's to follow. As an old friend, it was just great to catch up with her, and this was the latest in our series of live podcasts interviews that we've recorded in front of a live audience at Nottingham Central Library. So during the show, Natalie performs three tracks, which we've dotted between the interviews for your listening pleasure. And those tracks in order are Fortune Favours, Chasing Heaven, and In the Reverie. So look forward to those. Fortune Favours is coming up first. And yeah, look forward to the show.
One I've never known. One who makes better choices, nourishing her mind. But I'm not ready for reflection, I wanna stay blind. So let me do this in my own way. Oh, I know my fortune favors this waste of time. I know exactly why. I only want what's bad for me. Intruders in my mind. Ooh, I don't even sound the same. My mind ain't taking orders from my heart, yeah. So let me tell you something about me. You know I'll never change. So let me do this in the wrong way. Oh. Escaping voices in our minds. death for a while. We're only escaping voices in our minds.
Hi, this is Sophie from Left Lion, Nottingham's iconic culture magazine. Each month we publish a beautiful free magazine that shines a light on the art, music, food, literature and more that makes Nottingham such a vibrant and creative city to live in. It's a bit unusual for a local print magazine to exist these days, but we've managed to keep going for over 20 years, giving the city's artists, photographers and writers a platform to publish their work. We distribute 15,000 copies in over 300 venues across the county, and you can find Left Lion in every local library, every Castle Rock pub, in all active Nottingham leisure centres, and all the best bars, cafes and hangouts in Nottingham. If you're ever in town at the start of the month, you may have seen our Left Lion bike rolling around the streets. In line with our pledge to be a carbon neutral company, we deliver our magazines on foot, by electric bicycle, or where strictly necessary, by van. You can also read the full magazine and lots more for free at leftlion.co.uk. Check out the events listings on our website to find out what's going on in Notts, and if you'd like to promote your business or organisation with us, please visit leftlion.co.uk/advertise.
Just a disclaimer, me and Natalie are really old mates, basically. So we went to Rushcliffe School together. I was in the year above you, and we were sort of in the... Turn your radios down, please. Can you all turn your walkie-talkies off, please? Yeah. And we were sort of in the, you know, sprawling friendship group, then derogatively termed the Gregs. Everyone loves Gregs. Grebs. Grebs was what we were, wasn't it? Mm. I think it was maybe your... I was at a birthday party at your, like, 14th birthday party at your house. So we go way back, basically. And it's thanks to Natalie that I got my first job programming in London, because I did my time in London. We'll talk about London.
Did my time, because I like prison.
Tell me about it. I mean, it was for me, but we'll talk about your experience of it and see if it was any better, or is any better. It was your then partner working behind the bar at the Elgin in Ladbroke Grove that got me in there. So anyway, basically, we go way back. So this is going to be a bit mates catching up at points, and we'll try and keep it, you know, keep the you guys in the room. So... How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me and for giving me a history lesson of my life. My memory is poor, so some of this stuff, I'm like, oh, yeah. Yeah, my boyfriend at the Elgin, and then you were working there, and just that happened. And it's a lot, like, I find my memory is, I don't know what's wrong with it. I'm a very forward-thinking, like, what's next person. So looking back, I find tricky, which... It's not going to make this very easy, is it, for you? Sorry.
I'm not expecting it to be easy.
Oh.
I struggle with the same thing. Yeah. I'm terrible at recalling everything. You know, when people say, November the 27th, 2019, yeah. I was there and I was, you know, speaking to this person and he said this. I can't even quote back, like, I can't do quotes from my favourite films or anything.
Me neither. Like, and even you saying my first EP came out in 2007... I'm not sure about that, because I was very young, but, like, I was very young. I can't remember. I remember a lot about it, though, which is the important thing. The experience of working with Farmyard Records and the musicians I was working with at the time, that's a memory I have.
Let's dig into that.
Well, Let's talk about that.
How was the experience of... So Farmyard Records is Tommy
yes.
Farmyard. His real name is unknown to this day. So how did you get started there?
Me and Tommy go way back. He's one of my best friends, you know. And at the time, it's funny because I just finished college and I was looking at going to university to study music and carry on music. I did music at college, diploma course at Clarendon College, which doesn't exist anymore, I think. But Tommy was at the same time setting up a little record label called Farmyard Records, and I was already sort of making my way with bands and different musicians at that time. And he said, how about don't go to uni and just, this makes it sound like he was a really bad influence, but
ruined your life.
He ruined my life. I could have been someone.
It to us all.
I think at the time it just made more sense for me to stay and carry on with what I was doing in Nottingham, which led me to making this EP, which we put out.
Well, he's a large part of the reason that I successfully delivered the first Hockley Hustle Festival, and a large part of the reason of encouraging to carry on to a second year, and has now been doing the business on it ever since the last 18 years we started.
Wow.
So you must have been getting started around, I don't know if you're at that first one in 2006, but so what was the very first, like, when did you realise you wanted to be a musician, or you were like, you know, super into music? When did you first start playing?
That's an interesting question. Like, I don't remember, and this is going to sound really woo-woo, and what a creative. She's so different. No, like, but genuinely, I don't remember not wanting to do music. There was not this, and I find that that's a privilege that I have, actually, because most young people struggle. Even if you have a proclivity towards music, you still have this thing of, maybe I do this, or maybe I have a backup plan, maybe I should get a real job and study and do something else as a backup plan. I don't remember having that. Like, I remember my earliest memories in primary school talking to other kids about, what do you want to be when you grow up? And my answer was, I want to be a pop star. And they would be like, yeah, but I remember having this one conversation with this one boy. And he said, and by the way, we were both maybe 5 or 6, and he was a very mature boy for this, because he said to me, but you might want to choose something a bit more realistic. And I was, we're both 5. I was like, come on, have a dream. But no, I remember at that time feeling very much like, I know all the other kids, this is the thing I thought, I remember thinking, I know all the other kids are saying it, but I mean, I actually am going to be. I mean it. Which, by the way, was delusional. But I just remember having this knowledge that, or this feeling that music was always going to be a part of my life. And there was nothing else that I ever wanted to do or would have been good at doing, really. It's more that it's pretty much the only thing I'm good at, if you want to look at it that way.
Well, there's a pretty high failure rate in people that start out wanting to be pop stars and failing somewhere along the way, isn't there? So I think it does take, you know, it's a selection of that. Does anyone ever fall into music? I'm not sure. I think it's like there's, you know, all your dedicated people, and then it's just how much are you willing to put yourself through to get there?
Exactly.
Isn't it?
You'd have to be crazy in some respects to be an artist. I think that we all have a little bit. I think most creatives have a little splash of something else. There's a little splash of neurospiciness going on. And I certainly do. But, like, it's great. I'm saying that that's my experience with most people that I know in creative industries. But you would be surprised at how many people are career musicians. And I say that in the sense of there's people that can play an instrument and are very business about it. Like, I'm going for this pop gig. I'm going to do all the auditions to get there. And I'm going to, like, make as much money as I can playing the guitar. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that for me, it was more of a kind of calling. It's sort of part of my identity as a human being. I can't not do it, which is different for other musicians.
We were just having a chat before this that I think's worth getting into. Like, you know, we've known each other a long time. You've always given me introvert vibes. Yeah, you get up there on stage and you belt it out. And, like, do you have a kind of, has there always been a bit of a conflict between maybe being quite, you know, quite a reserved person a lot of the time, but then also having to get up there in the limelight and, you know, be this band leader, be this singer, like,
Yeah, I'm really shy. I'm a very shy person naturally, and definitely a massive introvert. And for me, the performance aspect of music has been something I've worked really hard at. I'm not a natural performer, which is so silly because why am I doing it? But yeah, I just think I'm a nerdy musician and I like being in a little room and writing music and composing and arranging and stuff. The performance, the being on stage in front of people and showing off like that is not, it's not naturally part of my personality. But you fall into it because when you can sing and you can play an instrument, there's the natural progression of that is to do gigs. So you learn. But yeah, I'm not one of these people that's like a natural born entertainer and darling, just give me a microphone and a stage and I'll put on a show. That's, yeah, that's not me.
Does it kind of, do you find it takes it out of you being, you know, feeling like a bit of an introvert? Do you have to kind of balance it with like just completely shutting everyone out for a few days after a gig or something? Or like, how does that work?
Yeah, I think so. But you know, because I've done it for so many years, you learn that that's not acceptable necessarily. That's not acceptable behaviour for everyone. My natural instinct, yes, I would love to crawl into a hole after my gigs and just rest and, like you said, recover and recharge. But that's not life. So yeah, I've learned how to deal with it and be and operate as a normal person once I've done a gig. But yeah.
Well, you're doing really well, and for all your talk of having no memory and not being able to recall things and preparing me, lowering my expectations for giving interesting answers, yeah. I think you're doing really well. So
thank you. Am I doing all right? Okay, good. Yeah. Thanks, everyone.
Round of applause. Yeah, why not?
Oh, no, stop it. Stop it.
So you've just got a round of applause for successfully answering questions.
Yeah,
that
I know.
Must be the cheapest round of applause.
This is more of an achievement than when I actually played a song. So yeah, thank you.
Maybe you should get into like talking and stuff and just
absolutely just not. Imagine.
So I'm also interested to learn that I'm just cradling the sheet, but this is a question that's not on there. So
okay, oh no, going off script already.
I know. Yeah, I did warn you that yeah it was going to be like that. But you're doing some teaching now. Do you want to talk about that? And like how do you kind of help like yeah. your young people come out of their shell? And
well, I very much fell into teaching. I've never fancied myself as a teacher. I'm still don't, to be honest. I identify as a musician first. But teaching has come about and it's obviously handy, you know, you've got to pay the bills and stuff. So I'm doing one day a week at BIM, which I don't know if you know BIM, it's the, I think it's the British Institute of Modern Music, and they have a few of them around the world now, Berlin, London, Brighton, and I'm what they call a specialist coach. So I go and work with the master's students, and the master's students are all like, they're in their 20s usually, sometimes a bit older, so they're not kids, and I'm helping them with songwriting and singing. I really like it, and I really feel as though it allows me to kind of get out some of my almost maternal energy, because a lot of them are young girls as well, and they're all just aspiring artists, and they're all doing what I was doing 10 years ago, and trying to move up a scene and express themselves as artists, but in a completely different climate to the one that I came up in. And I love to be able to impart wisdom and warn them about certain things in the industry and nurture them.
Well, that's an interesting, we can't not pry into that. What would you warn young people about getting into the industry today?
I think that one thing that's really becoming more and more necessary now is to be autonomous in everything you do. So it's even more so than when I was signed to Decca and all that 12 years ago or whatever it was. When I was sort of the last batch of artists that were signed on a whim. So when I say that, it was when record labels used to take a chance. So they would see you and think, hey, she's got potential. We're going to give her a massive record deal and hopefully she becomes a star. And if you didn't become a star, they would drop you and it was okay. They'd give you an option for another album and maybe pick up the option, maybe they didn't. In my case, they didn't. Nowadays, it's like you must be the finished article before we even look at you. It's hard. It's very hard. You have to have a certain amount of followers on all your socials. You have to sort of have your demos together to a degree anyway. My demos were not together. I recorded them on an 8-track, and they were on MySpace. Shout out to anyone who's old enough to remember MySpace, but that's when that's when I was signed. So it's kind of, but coming back to the pitfalls of these things, being autonomous is really important, I think, because if you're not, you're open to being taken advantage of in so many ways, especially as a young girl, sadly, a young woman. it's not, you don't, what you don't want is somebody who's going to be like, hey, pop up in your DMs, I can manage you, I can be your producer, I can do this, this, and this for you, and then you don't know what you're entering into. So it's sadly the case with a lot of creative industries where that stuff happens. On the plus side, because I have to balance it out a bit, I think the good thing about it, you can be anything you want to be, so to speak, any genre of music, and there's probably an audience for you because it's one upload away, you know. You put your song online, a few people will hear it and they'll probably like it. Whereas back before everything was digital, you were relying on HMV and just record shops to bring in customers, business for you. Whereas now there's an audience for you. So there is positives, but yeah, there's negatives too.
Yeah, there's not the same level of like gatekeeping, and you know, it's not as, there's not such a well-defined track into the music business as there used to be, maybe, and it is more about getting out there and expressing yourself and being, in, you know, individual and building that following, which is, yeah, I mean, yeah, it's wildly different. And yeah, MySpace, like Hockley Hustle was built on MySpace when
literally
we got inside. It was on all the old original posters, like
good old Tom.
Yeah.
Remember Tom?
All right.
That was his photo, yeah. Next! Just kidding, I'm kidding. Sorry.
So I
shouldn't have had that wine.
It's all right. And I think it's doing...
Edit that bit, yeah.
It's doing just the trick. We do, listeners at home, we do have a glass of red wine each here. So it's an experiment, really. I think it's the first one of these we've done with a glass of wine in hand.
Oh, whatever.
Yeah, normally we have it around the back. And then, tell me a bit about, like, we won't spend too much longer on the distant past, but you talked about, you know, and I mean, you pretended it was 10 years ago. I think it must have been a little bit longer that you were cutting your teeth as a musician.
What did I say was 10 years ago?
Well, you said with the young people that you're teaching now.
Oh, yeah.
You were like, you know, 10 years ago when I was just like...
Oh, no, I meant when I was their age. They're in their mid-20s.
Oh, fair enough.
They're not, like I said, they're not like fresh out of college.
Yeah, I thought we were pretending this was very recent history. But so how did you get started? What kind of tuition do you get? What kind of, you know, first steps? Because you started when you were a teenager, really, right?
Yeah. I had, when I was a child, I had piano lessons for a few years from this amazing piano teacher. So just, okay, to backtrack a little bit, my first ever piano lesson was when I was 5 years old, and I used to go to the lessons, and I used to pretend I was reading the music, because it was all like sight reading, like here's middle C, play middle C, and that's what it looks like, and then you get like D, and you have to, on the stave notation. But I used to listen to the song that she would play it to me first, and then I would listen to it and play it back. And so my teacher would think, oh my God, you're such a quick learner, you know, you're reading the music really well, but really I was learning by ear. A few weeks of that went on, and she found out, she was like, you're not really reading the music, are you? You're just learning by ear. And she said, I don't know what to do with you. Like, I can't teach you anymore and that's fair enough, because I think if you've got a classical method of teaching, you know that you learn to sight read and then you learn how to play. You kind of do it together. But my ears were much faster than my processing power when it comes to reading. So I went to this woman called Helen Kettering, and she understood me. And so she took me through, she basically helped me to develop my ears. So rather than looking at sight reading music, she thought, okay, this child has the potential to play by ear, so let's put her in the jazz grade, we'll do the jazz grades. So I did the ABRSM jazz grades. This was only, I'm talking about 3 years of my life, but before I started secondary school, I'd already done all that. So I already basically had a bit of a knowledge of piano before I got to secondary school, thanks to Helen. And then I think for the rest of my life, I'm pretty much self-taught, but having that rudimentary entry into piano because of her, like, it gave me that basis, and that's how I'm able to write songs, you know.
I think it's a good lesson in working with the child, isn't it? Not like, you know, trying to impose that sort of particular learning method on
100%.
Them.
100%, yeah.
But you've always had a bit of a classical flavor, well, not always had, but certainly when you started out, it felt like, you know, Devil and Me, so first album, it felt like you were bringing through a lot of the sort of classical vibes and things like that. And the writing was, you know, so I mean, you know, just want to get on to sort of comparing your opus so far. It was quite, it's quite a painful, almost not painful. I mean, it wasn't a painful listen.
No, you could say that.
But no, there was a lot of pain in it and stuff, wasn't there? So can you sort of talk us through where you're at with Devil and Me, where you got to with Free, and like how you've evolved musically?
Yeah, well, just going back to the classical thing, it's so funny because people, I've heard that a lot, that people say, I can hear a classical influence in your playing, particularly on that album, Devil and Me. And I was, like I say, I was never classically trained. I just have, I think that one of the, I guess one of the really beautiful things, but also one of the downfalls of my education in music is that I've ingested every type of music. And that's why when I wrote Devil in Me, it was so non-genre specific that it was very hard to sell and market, and people weren't sure where to place it. It's a little bit classical, it's also a little bit bluesy, it's also this. And that's just as a result of my, like I said, my consumption of so much music over the years, because I've just inhaled music my whole life, all of it, from rock through to classical, through to blues, everything. So that was why, I guess, that sounds like that. And yeah, talking about the pain, like, without getting super deep and almost philosophical about it.
We can do.
Okay, I will. Music is where I belong. I was listening to this podcast recently with Trevor Noah, actually, and Stephen Bartlett, and Trevor Noah talked about a place of belonging and that everybody should have that, wherever that is, whether it's, you know, with family and friends, whether it's fishing, I don't know, like somewhere where you feel like you are just you. You're not performing for your manager or like your children, or you're just the essence of you. And some people may struggle to find it even. But for me, I was really, for some reason, and I'm not religious or anything, and I don't believe in God, but I may believe in a higher power. I never didn't have that sense. It was just, I knew for some reason that music was where I belonged. So from a really young age, you know, my parents fighting, stuff's going wrong at school, whatever it is, I was at the piano writing. No one taught me like how to write a song. I just, for some reason, I understood how to express myself through the medium of a piano and a vocal. I'm not the best singer, and I'm not the best piano player either, still to this day, but I, for some reason, just understood it. And it just was how I got it out. There was no diary, I didn't write it down. So that's why I think you say there's pain, because it's all I knew. So writing a song like Devil in Me, I had to write it. I wasn't writing it for an album to be released. I had to write it because I needed to get that out of me because of what was happening in my life. So that's why it's painful.
And we had a quick chat before about the tracks that you say, so you're going to be performing a few tracks in a little while, which I'm really looking forward to listening to. And would it be weird, like you were like, oh no Devil in Me, and like is it weird kind of revisiting that music now, or would you just like, how do you feel about it now?
It's like it's like looking at a photo of yourself from a period of your life which was really embarrassing or or just like not who you are anymore. That's how it feels like. You know, when you see a photo of yourself and you're like, God, what was I wearing? What was my hair doing? Ugh, no, I'm so much better now. It feels like that. I know that sounds, I'm not trying to put myself down. I look back on my younger self with a lot of tenderness and compassion, and that's great for where I was at the time. And it actually was great for where I was at the time. It was a mature sound for the age I was, for sure. I was 18 when I wrote Devil in Me, 22 when we recorded it at Real World Studios. By the time it came out, I was only 23. So it, you know, I was doing some big things for that age, but like, I look back now and I'm like, cringe. So it is very hard. Yeah, in a short answer, yes, it's hard to look back on it, rightly or wrongly.
So tell us about the last album then, Free. So 2020 came out. What happened in the interim? What changed, and how was that reflected in that work?
I just grew up, I think. I just grew up as a musician. I think that, and the beautiful thing about music is, for me, I'm at the beginning of my journey, even now. In my 30s, I'm still at the beginning of my journey. I feel like I'm never going to stop being excited by the piano and excited by music. So, you know, Free is just another point, a drop in the ocean of my life, of where I was at that time. And in between Devil and Me and Free, I put out an electronic EP that was very experimental and different. And obviously since that time, I've been writing, and I've always been writing. And I think, but Free is the second official album I had. But there's been a sort of journey that took me from Devil in Me to Free, which is some of it's online, and a lot of it is just me growing up as a person.
Feels calmer and more assured, you know, is that right?
It is right, yeah. I mean, Free, I would say, and again, this is just so... It's just that I'm a musician, so my life is documented that way, but I know it's the story for everyone's life. I got to a point, I think at the age of about 27, where I felt like that was the last year where I was a bit crazy. And then I started to calm down a bit. And I think we know now, I guess, that your frontal cortex actually does develop up to a point. I think it's the age of 25, isn't it? So like, actually I wasn't fully developed before then. And it's very notable in my trajectory as a musician. I came out of a really tough relationship at the age of 28, 27. I say it was really tough. It wasn't tough, the relationship itself, but it was... I had a breakup, and I'd never had a breakup before where I had to end the relationship. I ended it, which sucked. I've only ever been dumped. I don't know what it feels like to be the dumper and not the dumpy. So I think...
Being dumped's way easier, I reckon.
It's easier, isn't it? Like, because the responsibility and the burden of it, and the realisation that you're hurting someone. And so a lot of the music on Free is about that. But then also, ironically, there's other songs on Free that are about a relationship I found. So I found a new guy. So a lot of those songs are about him as well, which is unfortunate. But and I called it Free because a lot of changes were happening. I left this relationship. I'd moved into a different phase of my life. I moved from St. Albans back to London, because I went to St. Albans with this boyfriend I was with and moved back to London. Big deal. Had vocal cord surgery as well, which was horrendous. So I couldn't speak for 6 weeks. So I was writing some of that album in complete silence. So being able to speak again was quite freeing. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Do you want to talk about the surgery? That must be fairly traumatic for a singer.
It was. And I mean, because of the context of everything else going on, just having that breakup, and meeting this new boyfriend I was talking to at the time, who was on tour. He's a musician too, he's my bass player, and he was on tour. So there was this like weird stuff going on in my life, basically, and I ended up at my mum's house again, just living there, recovering from this operation, whilst communicating with this new guy I was seeing, and breaking up with my old guy, and couldn't speak. Honestly, vocal cord surgery is really horrible, because so for the first 2 weeks you can't speak, like that's just no sound, nothing. So I had a bell. I know, my mum gave me a bell, so I used to ring this little bell if I wanted. Not that I was like ringing the bell, like, mother, I'm ready for my dinner. No, like I didn't actually use the bell. The bell was quite a joke, but it was really difficult because you. But sorry, what I'm trying to say is that 2 week period, you can't speak. The next 2 weeks, you can speak for 5 minutes a day. Now, that's harder, because when you can speak for 5 minutes a day, people think, oh, we're having a conversation, and then it stops. And I'm like, nope, no more, because you're supposed to practice speaking again. You have to train your vocal cords again to get back to a point of correct, like, elasticity and strength. And it was pretty savage.
Why did you have to, if you don't mind me asking, why did you have to have the surgery then?
I had nodules and I had a polyp. So these are things that are quite common for singers who overuse their voice. And I mean, we can talk about living in London if you want, because I'm sure we're gonna, but surviving in London, especially after being dropped from my label, you know, you don't have that cushion anymore of the label. So I had to make a living just gigging, and I was gigging 5 nights a week, and the gigs that I was doing were like intense. Gigging 5 nights a week, singing for 3 hours a night, not using my voice properly, you know, drinking a bit too much probably. So all this stuff led to me having these vocal problems.
I'm shocked about the drinking. I didn't know you liked to drink.
No, only a sherry at Christmas.
How long have you been in London now?
12 years.
Don't they issue some sort of medal after like 10 years?
They better.
Yeah, they should do.
And where's my medal? I need an awards ceremony, yeah.
I managed 6 years, which was definitely 3 years too long.
Yeah. It's hard.
But it's not about me anyway. I won't get into my...
Same one.
No, I mustn't. Mine was actually... I stayed for the extra... After 3 years, I met someone and I was like, I'm really depressed and I need to get out of London, otherwise I'm going to go mad. And then I stayed for another 3 years. And then they booted me out of London and sent me back to Nottingham. And it was the best thing ever. Isn't it nice being back in Nottingham?
It is really lovely. And I love Nottingham. And I have so much love for Nottingham. I love London. And I do agree, it's hostile. That's the word I would use. The first honestly, like the year, it takes 2 years. That's what I think. It takes 2 years to come from anywhere else and get used to London. I do remember like one of my first experiences getting on a bus and asking like, excuse me, does this bus go to Baker Street? And the bus driver was like, no. And he just closed the doors. And I was like, oh, this is my reality now. They're not trying to help you.
But you get looked at like an alien if you try and thank them on the way.
Literally,
out.
Yeah. But no, I think London's not for everyone, but you kind of have to, I don't know. You have to love it and appreciate it and understand it for what it is, you know.
What is it?
It's. I know, right? It's so hard to even explain because when you really put it on paper, it's terrible in so many ways. But it's vibrant and it's where opportunities lie.
For two decades and nearing 200 printed issues, Left Lion magazine has shone a light on Nottingham's culture and entertainment scene. We believe we are part of what makes the city unique. Not many others in the country or world have a free independent press like us. Left Lion is Nottingham's meeting point for information about what's going on in our city, from the big companies and issues to the grassroots, promoters and community organisations. Our printed magazine is free to access for all and we believe it's important it stays like that. However, we are increasingly relying upon donations from our readers to continue what we do. If you'd like to support our work, then you can do so by making a monthly pledge at patreon.com/leftlion. By pledging just £2 per month, you'll help make a real difference and will receive the digital copy of our magazine before it's available in town or on our website. If you pledge £5 per month, we'll also print your name or the name of a loved one, your band, your small business or your pet in each issue. If you can support us with a pledge of £10 per month, we'll also send you each issue through the post and you'll receive an art print of the cover with each copy, plus occasional other free gifts too. For more details about supporting Left Lion, please visit patreon.com/leftlion.
But deep down inside it knows it can't lose her. so stuck on the other side. She's so stuck on the other side.
I've reached the point, I've been back in Nottingham for about 6 years now, but maybe just over, and I've reached the point where I visit London for leisure. Yeah. Like, I've gotten over that kind of like post London traumatic stress disorder. And But yeah, no, I like going back for a bit. And I mean, surely as a musician, there's barely anywhere in the world you could be better poised for getting lots of gigs and meeting lots of people. And is it still like, how essential do you think being part of that London thing is for musicians these days, or has social media changed everything?
I wouldn't say it's changed everything. I think there is still merit to being in London, like I say, but it's changed a lot. I think you can quite feasibly have a career and do quite well outside of London. And also there's the wider thing of just the UK in general, talking about the music scene. It's very oversaturated. And because I've done a lot of gigs now abroad, which I've been really privileged to do, like in all over the world, the respect level for music and musicians in general is just a different thing elsewhere. And I think as an artist in the UK, we get very used to being treated quite poorly. And we think that's what it is, the arts, that's what it is. We're not respected as in the way that we are in Europe or in Asia or other places in the world. So it's less of a London-centric thing. It's more of a UK-wide thing, and possibly America as well.
As an artist, how has the music industry changed, and obviously the streaming and things now?
Yeah.
You know, how do you think, you know, what did it look like when you started? I mean, presumably there was more emphasis on selling records,
yeah,
getting a deal, doing all that. But yeah, what's it like? What's changed?
To be honest, for me, it hasn't changed significantly, for me personally, because I've never managed to break this particular ceiling of success where that has been a problem. I think whenever it was about record sales, I wasn't selling enough records. And now that it's about streams, I'm like not getting enough streams. So it's just a different number. One thing that has changed, and it's a detriment to all of us, is that the money that you're able to make from streaming is pretty poor. At least with a certain amount of record sales, you could actually make a decent amount of money, whereas with streaming now, it's become very much a monopoly, which is owned by Spotify and stuff like that. So, am I allowed to say that?
We say whatever we like about Spotify, and thank you, Spotify, for hosting this podcast as well. Just get in there. You know,
sort it out, Spotify.
Other terrible
streams,
streaming
please.
Services are available as well. I mean, not that Spotify's terrible or anything. But no, we all use it, don't we? And it's amazing having access to so much music and just being able to, you know, stuff so readily available. But I honestly, yeah, it's pretty bad how little. I think sometimes, am I actually buying any records? Not very. I mean,
yeah.
What have we even got to play them off these days?
Exactly. Well, the way that music is consumed is different in every way. It's like there isn't the ceremony anymore of buying a record or an album when you would wait for it to come out, or you would go to a physical shop to buy it, and it was a whole thing. That's just not, doesn't exist anymore. And I think, and also it does affect artists. I will say that is the one thing that when you are releasing music, there's still the whole, your whole heart goes into it. So like I put a single out about 6 weeks ago, and there's just so much, you know, I got real instruments, you singing it, recording it, producing it, mixing it, everything, and your whole heart and soul's in it. And then one day it's on your phone, and the next day it's on everyone else's phone, and it's nothing happens. It's very anticlimactic releasing music now. It's like, my album's out. It's just like you look at your phone, it's like, there it is. It's kind of like, and I think you just feel like you're throwing it into a cesspit of other music, and it's just in the ether now, and it's just ethereal. It's different. It's just different, you know.
And attention spans are just not what they were, are they?
They're not. Like, mine's not.
Doom scrolling. Yeah, no, I'm thinking of myself.
We're all victims of this. I'm the same. I'm addicted to my phone. I'm always on Instagram. I'm always on Reels. I'm always on TikTok, and et cetera, et cetera. It's a symptom of the times that are changing. But one thing I will say is, there's no point. I'm not someone who's sitting around miserable and like, oh no, there's no point. We just have to adapt. And it's the same with everything. It's like AI is here. Technology is here. It's advancing beyond us. There's no point as a musician being afraid of it and frightened and allowing that to, I guess, allow us to rebel or be angry. We have to go with it, unfortunately, and it is seeing the positives of it in it.
So, just moving on to, I'm not going to allow this interview to end without us getting into the topic of Goldie, because I'd love to hear about you. You've done loads of work with him. You've done loads of work with. When I've heard you popping up on the radio, most recently, it's generally been on, you know, or there's been, it's been often been on dance tracks and stuff. So you've obviously done loads of. You talked about your electronic EP that you did.
Yeah.
Are you good pals with Goldie? So you did your last album release with him, and has it been helpful having those kind of characters around to kind of help, you know, guide you through the maze of the industry and that kind of thing?
I mean, I owe Goldie a lot, because without Goldie, I wouldn't have got signed, because I did this documentary called Goldie's Band, and the whole point was that he took different young people from areas of the UK, and we all had to face different adversities, different challenges. And the point was that we had to perform a concert and write all of the music for Buckingham Palace, so which was going to be full of all kinds of dignitaries and people. And Prince Harry was there. It was
former Prince Harry.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh yeah, it's just Harry now, isn't it? Yeah, Harry was there.
I think he still gets the HRH, but I don't know. I don't know what it stands for anymore or something. I don't know.
I don't know. It's just to sell a book.
I'm not going to speculate now. Yeah.
But no, he was there. The Queen wasn't there. Obvs. She's above that. Yeah. Yeah, RIP. Charles wasn't. But no, so that was the premise of that. And that's how I know Goldie, because he... Well, him and the BBC at the time scouted me for that, which was amazing. And so from there, we've kept a connection and carried on working together. So over the years, I've toured with him. I've written quite a lot with him over the years. And yeah, to answer your question, is it good to have people like him around to navigate the industry? I think being around people like Goldie and other characters of that nature, it teaches you lessons about who's in the industry. I think... you learn how to navigate it as an independent artist and as a woman. And I emphasize heavily as a woman, you know. There's so much misogyny in the industry, and there's so much proving yourself you have to do that I'm actually kind of, even at this point in my life, still doing. So it's, you know. But me and Goldie are friends, like you said. We are friends. We have had our ups and downs, but we're friends.
Have you got any good stories?
He's mental, man. Like he's honestly, like, he's so much fun. He's so funny. He wears wigs. Do you know about his collection of wigs? Yeah, he has a collection of wigs that he like takes everywhere, so that he can just be different characters. He's got a character called Higgsy, who's like a posh guy. Who else does he have? He's got so many characters.
You could say he's on a bit of a wig flex.
Exactly. Yeah.
Just a crowbar in Nottingham promoter. Big up, Lucas. But yeah,
it's like,
hey, Goldie, what wig flex are you on today? You could actually ask him that.
I could. And he'll do stuff like, you know, you're recording a vocal take in the sound booth, and you'll look through the window, and he's in the control room just wearing his boxers and a wig. Just stuff. He just likes to pull pranks. He's a prankster.
I'm glad that's the light that particular episode.
I know, could have gone.
We weren't going to go.
Okay, no, definitely
down
not.
Another, but yeah, I mean, yeah, he seems like a lot of fun. He just seems to be popping up on my like social media feeds every other week these days. Like, he's always on some like documentary banging on about something, or you know, like some clip of him just.
Yeah, no, just, but he's Goldie is UK drum and bass royalty, and he's done so much for the UK garage drum and bass jungle scene. Not so much garage, but jungle and drum and bass scene. He's a pioneer, and he's quite legendary, and I don't think he necessarily gets his flowers in a lot of ways, but I know Goldie's someone who will take his flowers, and he should, because he's very talented.
I think because he's just got such a big personality, and he did the Celebrity Big Brother thing and stuff like that, he's kind of easy to dismiss or overlook or think, oh no, he's just he's a celebrity.
A bit of a comedy celebrity character, yeah, 100%.
But he's actually so serious he's actually pushing things forward, like just... The last clip I saw of him was literally just a couple of days ago, and it was, I don't know, he discovered some way of like using some kind of like piece of technological equipment to like make this. It was like the pitch, like pitch shifting. So like,
okay.
He made it like so all of his tracks sounded like had all these different things going on, and it was just him talking about that anyway, and like his with his sort of childlike like. Yeah, he's an appreciation of the sound.
He's an effervescent character, and he has, like you say, a childlike energy for music. And I think that's the reason that he connected, we connected. He connected with me, and he saw something in me and wanted to work with me.
Well, yeah, it's got to be. Know? I mean, he found you because he was trying to raise up, like you say, different genres of kids from different backgrounds.
Doing
not different genres of kids. Kids, you know.
Different genres of kids. Yeah.
We got the jazz kid. We got the...
Yeah.
you know, he's obviously, trying to kind of connect the dots and lift them up. And, I mean, you've worked with all sorts of people, other electronic producers like Disclosure and Lensman and, like, from... You know, electronic side to, I know Kat Eaton, who you've worked with, had her on back in the day. And, Bansangu Orchestra stuff as well. So, like, and tell us about, so you've been touring more recently, touring with Incognito. How
yes. For the last 2 years, I've been on tour with Incognito, like, everywhere. We've just been all over the world. It's been crazy.
How would you describe them to listeners that don't know of Incognito?
They're a jazz funk band, so it's exactly what that suggests. So this it's jazz with a backbeat and hooks that you can sing along to.
And you sing along to them?
I sing along like whilst the band are playing it and I'm on stage, yeah. exactly.
I'm seeing some approving nods in the audience from quarters where I expect to see approving nods about such a band. But yeah, they're pretty legendary, aren't they? And, you know, so you're gigging all over the world with them. How's that being part of like a massive... So how many... What does the band look like on stage? How many pieces are we talking?
There's loads of us. I think there's 10 of us. There's so it's drums, bass, guitar, obviously keys, horns, saxophone, trumpet, trombone, and then it's either three singers or four singers. And then Bluey, who is the band leader in the band, he founded the band. They've been going since 1979, and they've had so many different iterations of the band during that time. And yeah, I just happened to have been lucky enough to be part of the latest one. But yeah, like, it's so funny when you like just sort of read out my life in this way, because for me it sounds like it's happening to someone else, and I think that's a problem I have in a way. Something like Incognito, I still feel a bit like I have imposter syndrome. And the last 2 years, I've done Incognito and I've done Soul Family with Natalie Williams, which is another gig where it's very high level. Like, the singers are just the best singers in the UK. And then, like you said, the Bansangu Orchestra, which is Paul Booth, saxophone player, absolute genius, real all-round musician genius. And he asked me to sing for this gig where he put together a show for celebrating Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys. Again, what an incredible show. This has all happened to me really recently, and like, it's taking me a while to accept. Sorry to go into my own mind a bit, but it's just that when things like this happen, it's great, because number one, I always say this to my students, if you're the best person in the room, like the most talented, most intelligent, you probably aren't in the right room. You should be in these scary positions where you're forced to accelerate. But this has happened to me so much in 2 years, and it's taking me, it's amazing, basically, because I'm rising to this challenge of, okay, I'm in Incognito now, I have to be this level. I was operating here on a lower level before, and now I really have to step my game up. And it's the same with Soul Family. It's so stressful and so anxiety provoking and scary to be in these bands, but I'm working hard and I'm trying to, I think I'm trying to tell myself a lot of the time, you're here for a reason, and there is a reason why I'm here. It's not an accident. But
I suppose particularly as an artist, I mean, I think it applies to all walks of life, but you've got to keep doing things that scare you a little bit, haven't you, and challenge yourself. But yeah, particularly as an artist, you want to keep on that wave, and it's really good to hear, to be honest, that you're like feel like you're on that wave and in such a kind of learning, growing mode at the moment. So let's talk a little bit about your just released single and what you're writing, what you're working on. So, but I wanted to pick your brain about Fortune Favors. So,
yeah,
a single that just came out in early September.
September, yeah.
And I enjoyed the music video. Tell us about the music video. So
thanks.
It was like you've got your own like digital avatar.
Yeah.
Was that weird? Or
Yeah, well, no, I mean, I chose to do it, but I did. So with Tanya Subotic and Tom Bentall, they're animators, so they make cartoons, basically. They're wicked. I did a music video for my song Let Go Release, and it was animated. And it's actually, and I just love animation, really. I just like anime, and I like cartoons and just that. And I've always wanted a cartoon music video. So they did one for Let Go Release, which was amazing.
That was a bit more cartoonified, right?
Really, yeah.
More, yeah. And this one's quite realistic.
Quite realistic, yeah.
I had to double take a little bit when I was watching the video. I was like, it's, yeah, but...
Yeah, I mean, I'm just quite... I guess I'm quite fascinated in many respects of the sort of convergence of animation and AI, and not necessarily in musical terms. I want to keep that very organic. But in visual terms, I think it's really interesting. Like, we can use so many aspects of, I guess, artistic AI freedom to make art and make it different and cool. It's kind of the way it's going anyway, so, yeah.
Is this your long-term? Is your long-term aim to absolve yourself from having to perform anymore?
To become a cyborg?
Yeah.
Like, I want to be the first hologram. You know, like, they're all dead that do it. But I want to be living, and just that she can just do my gigs. Like, yeah, it's me. It's not a bad idea.
Well, I mean, you're pioneering in so many ways. If you could be pioneeringly lazy, and yeah, just
yeah, exactly, not, you
know, solve that whole thing. So yeah, talk to us about music you're currently working on. I've got a couple of names written down, but maybe I'll let you just tell us. So who you're writing with? You're working towards releasing.
Yeah.
Another album? Do you want to tell us about
I am, yeah. So Fortune Favours was the first song I've released on my own without a label. So I'm doing that. I'm independent now. So I'm putting out... My next single comes out in a couple of weeks. And then after that, next year, rest of the album. And it's literally just all me and my band. So I've got a drummer and a bass player, Dave Browning and Alan Meehan, and we've been a trio for many years, and we play at Peggy's all the time, so it's that. But for the first time, we're just producing it, and we're literally doing it at home, so at my actual yard at home. And it's a huge undertaking because I've never done it before. It's a lot of stuff, but I think it's time. I feel ready to not have any producer or label. I don't feel like, deep down, I don't feel like I've ever needed that stuff, realistically. And so now I just feel brave enough and bold enough and maybe cocky enough to do it, so yeah.
That's ace. And like, do you still put a bit of a team together? Like, are you like getting any help with like any promotion aspects? I'm not pitching myself.
No, please.
We do offer a full range of advertising options at Left Line Magazine.
Oh my God. No, I will do. Yeah, no, I will do that, definitely. Haven't really thought about it.
50% discount
honest.
For musicians, actually, and it's a decent
time.
Oh,
let's talk
to
after this.
There,
but, yeah.
sort you out. But in terms of like the PR and the that kind of side of things, like, do you think there's a need to do that kind of thing, or like, are you sufficiently platformed?
Oh my God, no! Of course I'm not. No one knows who I am. Of course I need PR, but I think the interesting part for me is writing it. So I'm still doing that, and then once that's done, then I look into that. It's really boring for me and I hate it, but I have to do it. It's a necessary evil.
Yeah, I mean, it's so competitive out there.
Sorry, that sounded like I was putting you down. It's so boring.
No,
it wasn't. I didn't mean it like that. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, all these journos and waste of space, really. Yeah.
All this press, man. Just want to live a private life.
But I've got down that you're doing some writing with some interesting characters as well. Is that just sort of on the sidey sort of stuff, or are you like?
Oh yeah.
You do loads of writing. You've written some of the greats, and
Well, I've just. I did a gig actually a couple of nights ago with Richard Spavin at the Jazz Cafe. It was the night before last. And so, yeah, I don't know if you know him. He's a phenomenal drummer.
Awesome. Yeah.
And I co-wrote the lead single for that album. And then working on Goldie again, but his new album, which is due to also come out next year. I've done a bit of writing on that with Misha Paris, and working with Misha Paris was a wicked experience. She's such a character, obviously, like UK soul royalty. So, yeah.
And you mentioned about Peggy Skylight. So is that your spot when you do come back and play? It's a vibe, isn't it?
It is. I love Peggy's. Yeah, it's great. It's just a really nice little miniature jazz scene of Nottingham, which I really enjoy. And I also like the fact that, talking of jazz, I also appreciate the fact that jazz is no longer being as gatekept as it used to be, because I don't consider myself jazz. I consider myself something, but something that's not quite pop, but it's not the older understanding of, like, it has to be bebop jazz, traditional jazz. And I think Peggy's much more open space for all kinds of music that isn't just commercial or jazz. Same with Ronnie Scott's, to be quite honest. They are also doing that.
Tell us about Ronnie Scott's. You did two sold out gigs there not so long ago. How was that? Was it like main room business, or is that a little loungy bit upstairs?
Main room. Ooh. Yeah. They've refurbished it, actually, so it looks even more ooh than it used to.
I've never been to a gig in the main room, but I used to go up to the jazz jams upstairs quite a bit, and yeah. I caught a few nice people there. But yeah, speaking of like jazz and it opening up, telling us about the gigs. How are the gigs?
No, it's fine. Ronnie Scott's, well, obviously, like, Ronnie Scott's is one of those places I think most musicians have in their minds. So for me, it was a dream when I was younger. I was like, I want to play at Ronnie Scott's. And now I've played there loads, and it's weird because I've played there not just with my own music, but with, like I said, Natalie Williams and Incognito and Goldie as well, actually. But what I will say about Ronnie's is it never feels normal. It never feels like, whenever I'm there, it always feels like a really big, scary thing that I'm doing. It's like, it's Ronnie Scott's. Ella Fitzgerald was once here. It's always got that, even no matter how many times I play it.
She did some of the late shows there, didn't she? Or super late in her career. Yeah.
It has an energy, and I hate that word because it's just a bit vague, but like, it does have, there's an electricity in there that you can't quantify.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
They've got electricity.
Yeah, they've sorted out the lights. Good one. I think it's that atmosphere. And I think because you appreciate what prestige it has, it forces you to not mess around at Ronnie Scott's. Like, everything you see there, everything you watch there is next level. So for me, getting to play there, it was, again, a bit like one of those imposter syndrome moments. But yeah, I'm playing there again in February.
Oh, do you remember the day?
The 15th, the day 15th. after Valentine's Day, yeah.
15th of February, get your tickets.
Yes,
listener.
If you would like to come, it would be lovely, really lovely.
So I think we might go to the audience for a few questions soon. Is there anything else you want to, like, you know, before you get sidetracked, is there anything else you want to say to listeners, fans, or you know, maybe it's that message to musicians and women. And
I would actually, like, I hope that anything I've, because I've been very honest in this chat, I hope that there's no part of it that has been any kind of a negative vibe about the music, not just industry, but the idea of being a musician and being, like, my biggest thing that I say to my students and anyone that's younger and trying to do it is, you've got to love it. If you love it, it starts there. It doesn't matter. The hard stuff will happen. It happens in any career. It doesn't matter what it is. But if you love it, if you feel like this is not something I can really do without having in my life, please pursue it. Don't let anything put you off it. Because the only reason I'm still here and actually having a decent career, and by the way, you can have a decent career without being bloody Adele in music. You can have a really nice career in it without that. Don't allow anything to put you off it. Just please go for it.
Hey everyone, it's Adam. So you'll notice a change in the voice asking the questions now. This is the bit where we go over to our live audience for a quick Q&A from them.
With your new music, are you physically distributing it, or is it just digital distribution?
I think it's just going to be digital distribution, but if I have the opportunity, I would love to do vinyl, but I'm going to have to see if that's an option at the time. But yeah, like, I would love to do vinyls, probably not CDs, but yeah.
Yeah, I would say vinyl over CDs. No one listens to CDs anymore.
Exactly. And like, the kind of nice souvenirs to be able to sell at a gig, but that's about it. And sometimes it works out better not to have them for the artist, but I would love to do vinyl. So fingers crossed, vinyl. Yeah.
I want a vinyl. Last question real quick. I was just going to ask, you know, with you doing it yourself this time and with being attached to labels before,
yeah,
is the post-production process, you know, with mixing and mastering specifically, a lot kind of more different? Are you approaching it yourself? You know, or is it kind of, because obviously when you're attached to the labels with Gordy and stuff, they would have their mixing engineers surely that they'd refer you to. So
yeah.
Are you still kind of having those links that you've had in the past, or are you kind of going, right, I'm doing it myself?
It's a good question. My drummer is mixing it. So he himself is not a professional mix engineer, but I've allowed him to sort of experiment with my music. So it's a lot of me and him sitting together in a room saying, no, that needs to be louder, that needs to be softer, blah, blah, blah. Like, we're just doing it together and learning together. But if you'd listen to my song Fortune Favours, that's one that we mixed together. See what you think. Let me know if you think it's all right.
Hi. Are you still doing Kendrick Lamar's All Right?
No, it's so funny. Like, someone reminded me about that recently, that they liked that my cover of that song. That was for this YouTube channel called Rap Renditions, and it was like singer-songwriters that they wanted singer-songwriters to do their own take on a rap song, like a hip-hop. And I love Kendrick Lamar, so I chose All Right just for that. So I've never really performed it live. I only did it for that session. But
No, you did perform it live.
Did I? Oh, okay, yeah, I can't remember. What did I say about my memory? Yeah. So in that case, no, I'm not doing it anymore.
It was about 8 years ago for University of Nottingham Black History Month, and you played it near the end of the gig.
Oh my God.
And I had not heard the song before.
No, you're right.
Absolutely knocked out. So I would say to you, you should put that back on your set.
Oh my God, thank you so much. I forgot about that. I completely forgot. You're right. Yeah, I did do it for that. I would definitely be up for bringing it back into the set.
You mentioned earlier about playing abroad. Apart from the UK, what's your favourite place that you've played? Favourite country?
I absolutely love Italy, anywhere in Italy, and Japan. I love Japan. And they're the places we've played the most, but Japan was my first tour that I did on my own, with my own music. And now I've been there twice with Incognito, and I'm going again in 2 weeks. It's amazing. Love Japan. Have to say Japan.
What is it? Is it the people, the crowds, the way you're treated?
Everything. It's beyond music for me with Japan. I think that for some reason I feel, maybe it goes back to me being an introvert and potentially a bit on the spectrum, that there's something very calming, and I feel as though I can breathe in Japan in a way that I can't in London. It's a totally different culture in every way, but in a really great way.
Decided your path would be the same. Safe in your own skin where darkness pulls away. Dance where the ground takes you, barefoot in the dark. And if light never becomes you, it's time to make a start. Oh, I'm falling forever for the person you once were. Take me forever to find you. was something about you that I could not let go. I know you were seeking nirvana, and after all this time I've waited for you to open up my mind. After all this time we're still chasing heaven.
Thank you so much.
Okay, welcome back to the studio. All right, the Left Line office. We hope you enjoyed that chat with Nat. And if you'd like to go and give her a follow or listen to all that lovely music we discussed, you can find Natalie Duncan on all good music streaming services, including Spotify, of course. So you can catch her live here in Nottingham at Peggy's Skylight on 28th of February, or if you can make it down to London, why not head to see her at the legendary Ronnie Scott's on 15th of February. So for more Left Line content, you can head to leftline.co.uk, or if you're in Notts, pick up a copy of our lovingly crafted free monthly magazine. And our next live podcast will be with BAFTA-winning actor Chanel Cresswell, and that's recording on Friday, 6th of December, so give us a week or two and you'll be able to listen to that. You can pick up free tickets to come and join us at the library at leftlion.co.uk/library. Thanks for listening all the way to the end of the podcast. We'll see you next time.